of runoff. The work was largely done by two master students who recently left and are just finishing their thesis up, Fred and Kate Eagleson. They're going to be off to the wilds of Peace Corps shortly. So, not doing pesticides. So what we're going to talk about today is the previous research that we've done under this program and this current project, why we did it, how we did it, and a little bit about results and conclusions. But this is something where we still have another year on the project. The results that we have in hand are only a piece of what we're ultimately going to have. So the emphasis here is on preliminary. This data is data that we've had compiled for something like 8 days now. So we've had a lot of time to think about it. Not too much. So it's going to be what we've got so far. So in the previous work, we studied small concrete slabs, sort of like Jay was talking about before. And in those slabs, the entire slab was treated, and then there was a rainfall simulation, and we saw it ran off. And one of the things we found was that there were two very distinct types of runoff profiles, one where a lot of the mass that ultimately ran off in the very first part of the runoff, and one where it was much more consistent. And the concentrations, the event mean concentrations, frequently were above the aqueous solubility of the compound. And we saw the longer the stuff sat there, the less ran off, the more intense it was the rain. You got a little bit more, but not that much more. But the key thing about this was that we saw a lot of evidence that we thought indicated that formulation was important. However, the study wasn't really designed to test the importance of formulation. In fact, Brandt Jorgensen, the person who did this preceding work, put formulation in as a variable. I didn't think it was going to be important, so I humored him. I said, sure, you can pick different formulations. But we had different formulations and different active ingredients, and they weren't all applied at the same mass rate, and there was a bunch of reasons that you couldn't easily compare across compounds or products to see that formulation was really a driving force. So we wanted to do this study in order to examine that. The other thing that happened with the previous study was that we saw some evidence that surfactant was really helping to mobilize the compound and move it off target. But part of the research is being the Frank Spurlock, living memorial piece of the research, because he kept saying, well, how do you know that after it leaves that source zone and it travels a meter or 2 meters or 3 meters, that the surfactant doesn't basically stick to the surface and then or the pyrethroid, either one, and now they're not together anymore. So there's a chromatographic separation as the stuff moves away from the source zone, and so maybe that solubilization effect happens in the source zone, but it may not persist to the gutter or to the storm drain. And so we wanted to see the effect of distance. So the basic idea here was, you take this aqueous formulation, usually. It's got a lot of surfactant in there. Here are little red squiggles are our active ingredient. There's some sort of micelle there. The stuff goes on the surface. The water evaporates. And maybe the stuff is sitting there on the surface in a kind of collapsed micelle or a flattened micelle or a dehydrated micelle, whatever you want to think of it as. Then when it rains, perhaps that stuff gets picked up and carried off in a complex form rather than a truly dissolved form. So we were looking to see in a much more systematic way than we did before whether formulation type matters in terms of the shape of the runoff profile, in terms of the amount of runoff of active ingredient that we see, whether we can connect the structure of the pyrethroid, of the surfactant to the runoff that we see, and then look at attenuation of both the pyrethroid and the surfactant as we move away from the source zone. So the approach was similar to what we did before in the sense that we used the same kind of rainfall simulators, drop-forming rainfall simulators as we had before. We collected gradations of runoff because obviously the concentration typically declines, so we need more volume in the later parts of the event to get enough signal. All of this stuff went through an SPE column, but then because we were looking for both surfactants and pyrethroids, we were able to take that SPE cartridge and first elute with methanol to get the surfactants off, and then elute with the hexane ethyl acetate mixture to get the pyrethroids off. So everything came off of one SDE column, and that worked pretty well, and there was a lot of method development behind that. And then because we can't just go out, we don't know what these surfactants are, we just know that they're in the formulation. What we did was to try and quantify those surfactants. We took the formulated product and we diluted it to various amounts. And we basically, for each band of the chromatogram, we said, okay, well, that peak, there's, you know, so many area counts in the original formulation, and we don't have stuff we put down. And so then we count area counts in the runoff, and we then scale that. So everything's relative to the original formulation without us really having a quantification. So it's very, there's no way in this to compare one surfactant to another inside of a formulation or one surfactant to another across formulations, but we can quantify for these various peaks. And the peaks aren't exact either, and so they're sort of hydrophilic and hydrophobic regions of the chromatogram, so we lumped our surfactants into hydrophilic and hydrophobic groups. Now, we are just in the process of installing a new high-resolution LCMS system, a QTOS system, which is going to be downstairs shortly, and then we should be able to say something more about the structure of these surfactants, and then we'll go back and reanalyze these things and get much more detail about the structure of the surfactants that are in these formulations. So the methods was pretty simple. This study was done with concrete apparatus like this little schematic. The green area was the source zone, so that was where the pyrethroid was applied, and these different runs are 1 meters, 2 meters, 3 meters, and 4 meters in length, and then you collect at the end of that run. And the idea was, well, let's see if we see attenuation down that slope. And so we were using the kinds of formulations this time that professional applicators would use. Last time, everything we used was an off-the-shelf, something that you could buy in a hardware store that a homeowner could buy. Now all the products are those that could be used by a registered applicator. And in this study, all rainfall intensity was held at 50 millimeters per hour. All of the set times were 24 hours because we previously looked at the effect of those two variables. So we weren't interested in that. We wanted to just test as many compounds as we could. And so this was as many compounds as we could. So we simply, the aim here was to test multiple formulations within each active ingredient type, but also use things that people actually use out there. And that created another constraint. So you'll see for S&Valrate, we only have one kind of formulation. For some of the other things, we have multiple formulations, but not the same multiple formulations as we have for other active ingredients. We're limited by what's in the marketplace unless we want to synthesize our own stuff. And of course, the percent AIs are in the product as we got it, not in the product as we applied it. Of course, they were applied in the same way that, you know, following the directions and so forth. We do actually read the labels, at least in the lab. And so you guys are all familiar with the formulation types, but one thing I should note is we actually put granular product on concrete. The labels on these particular products, you know, probably not, right? And certainly not now, but it is something that's in the study. There's only two granular products among the 20 products, but everything else is something that you really would probably typically see applied to a concrete surface. And then the other thing we were trying to do, based on our last study, was we were trying to harmonize the active ingredient amount applied across the different active ingredients, as well as within each of the different formulations for a given active ingredient. But we also wanted to stay within what we could do on the label. And so what we tried to do was, for all those products, we looked at all the range of application amounts that you should be putting on, and then we picked one application amount that worked for all of the formulations within that active ingredient, and then we tried to make them the same. And so you'll see that for everything but cypermethrin, we were able to do that, but the cypermethrin amounts that had to be applied according to directions were larger. So that's the one that really sticks out as being different. But I think you'll see it doesn't really drive the results as far as I can tell. So this is the kind of data that we get from these simulations. You'll notice there's four different symbols on each one of these. You can't see the last one over there, but it's just the 1 meter point, the 2 meter point, the 3 meter point, the 4 meter point. So The stuff in purple has traveled 4 meters from the source zone, green 3 meters from the source zone, and so forth. And what you'll see is there's no noticeable attenuation of either the surfactant or the active ingredient. So here we've got concentration versus cumulative runoff, which is effectively time because the rain falls on concrete at its constant rate. And we, as I mentioned, have grouped the surfactant into the hydrophilic stuff. That is the stuff that comes out before the pyrethroid peak. The hydrophobic stuff comes out after the pyrethroid peak. And then we track its runoff. And on the two surfactants, notice it says basis 100. That is 100%, or a unit. If it said 100, it would be coming off at the concentration of the originally applied product, right? So it's many times full of that. Whereas for the bifenthrin, it's obviously calibrated to the active ingredient. So this is one way of looking at the data, concentration versus time. Another way of looking at the data that Brandt used in his previous work was wash-off curves that are calibrated by basically you sum up everything that came off in one of these curves, and you take the cumulative mass that came off, and you call that 100%, and then you divide each time step up, or divided by that amount that constitutes 100%. And when you do that, you get curves that look like this, where the x-axis is the cumulative volume that ran off, right? So zero is before at the beginning of the storm, 100 is at the end of the storm, and everything goes up to 100% because it's all normalized by how much of that stuff came off in that particular event as measured. And so these are useful because they differentiate between things that show a first flush effect that have a very steep initial slope and then flatten out. Those are cases where the concentration drops a lot over the course of the storm, or the simulated storm. Straight line would mean the same concentration all the way along, right? So the more steeply curved these are, the more they fall into what Brandt called type A, first flush effect, and the straighter they are, we've been calling that type B. And so then one of the things we were just looking at was, do the patterns of the surfactant look anything like the pattern of the active ingredient? So I'm just going to, we've got data like this for every single one of those compounds that I showed you. I don't want to go through all that. Here I'm just going to show you the 5-bifenthrin products that we've got just for a comparison. They represent a range of different formulation types. And what you'll see is for all of these, there's occasionally some faint indication that there's some sort of attenuation in maybe the very first sample taken, but it's usually just noise. And so for the most part, the concentrations are the same at every distance from the source zone. And you'll see that sometimes the surfactant profile looks very different from the active ingredient profile, and sometimes not. So in this case, the hydrophobic surfactant seems to match up with the shape of the bifenthrin profile, whereas the hydrophilic surfactant doesn't. Here's an oiled version, and this one has potentially the big, at least the 1 meter point is the largest in all cases of the first data point. But systematically, there's no significant attenuation for any of the products that we looked at, for any of the surfactants we looked at. And often we see a better correlation between the late eluting surfactants, the hydrophobic stuff, than we do with the hydrophilic materials. But interestingly, more of the product had detectable hydrophilic surfactants in them than hydrophobic. Telstar, this was the green or Telstar, and what we can say at this point is we just got correlations between things. We have a lot more to do with respect to cataloging the surfactant, understanding what the structure is and whether it matters for this. And sometimes with the detection methods we have right now, we couldn't detect surfactants in the runoff because of the sensitivity of the equipment and so forth. So those are cases where we definitely have to go back. There's only two of those cases out of the 20 products that we had. So to summarize, what this table shows is for all the products that we've got data on, what percent of the original originally applied surfactant ran off during that simulated storm, and what percent of the hydrophobic surfactant ran off during that simulated storm, and then what percentage of the pyrethroid ran off. And so other than the fact that the two granular products on concrete ran off the most, big surprise, right, the rest of it doesn't show any obvious correlation with the type of the formulation. So the pyrethroid runoff under these conditions doesn't seem to be a big, doesn't seem to be driven by formulation. It may still be driven by specific types of surfactant, right? We don't yet know that. And because we can't really quantify the surfactants in a way to compare across products, we need a lot more information. And we will get that information. That's still part of the study. It's just that we've completed the runoff simulations, we've completed some of the analytical work, but not all of it. You'll see that in some of the cases, quite large fractions of the applied surfactant ran off, but that doesn't necessarily go along with particularly elevated concentrations. Our previous work suggested that suspension concentrates were particularly prone to high degrees of washoff. That doesn't necessarily seem to hold across a much broader spectrum of products, so it may have just been those that we tested before. Another key thing, though, is that because of the way we designed this study, we were so interested in attenuation that we actually don't have data at 0 meters, right, which is what we had in our previous study. So it's possible that you would see a formulation effect at 0 meters, and there is attenuation, but the attenuation is all done by 1 meter from the source zone. So still some questions that aren't answered. And then we also just did this thing where we tried to type them into type A and type B and see whether there was any systematic behavior there. And once again, there's not really any great overwhelming obvious result from this other than that different things behave differently. Another way to look at the data is the runoff and group it by formulation. Notice that this is a log scale on the side. And once again, what you see is, other than the fact that the granular products had a higher runoff percentage than everything that wasn't granular, everything else, there's no clear trend with formulation type. So, so far it's looking like Jay's particles may win out over formulation in terms of the explanation for this. And this is just cataloging how much of the surfactant that we were able to measure came off, and once again, even the surfactant runoff, at least as a fraction of what was applied, doesn't depend on the type of formulation. So, what we see is there doesn't appear to be any significant attenuation, that whatever, in whatever form this stuff is being carried along, it's not changing that much over at least a 4 meter distance. Now, the other thing that should be noted is because of this particular set of studies and this particular apparatus that we built, all these studies were done indoors, so it's not like it's dust-free, but it doesn't have any of the outdoor influences that we might have had in our previous study or that a lot of the work that Jay's done might show. And so we don't see any clear, as yet, distinction about how formulation affects the runoff of the active ingredient. We still think that there's some possibility that specific surfactants may be more or less responsible for runoff, and we'll check that once we have more data on their structures. And, so the, you know, my interest now is in moving, and I should say that the future work that I'm talking about here is the future work that will be done under the current project that we're already doing. So in terms of future work that we're going to do, beyond that project stage, a lot of my interest, as we've been talking about at lunch and around here, is I'm interested in things that make byproducts and the persistence of those byproducts. I think fipronil is a real interesting compound in that regard, and so we'd like to work on that. And stuff that I was talking about before with Jay, the particle characterization, I think there's a lot of opportunities there in terms of size and what's riding on which kind of particle and how much of that particle. That's all I wanted to do.